Hello. Today I am at the brilliant venue in Bilston, the Robin, and tonight, the 11th of July, a flock of seagulls are playing as part of their tour, new album, In Flight. So on this episode, I'm talking to Mike Score, frontman of the band.
Yes, here we are.
Yeah. So, is this the first gig of the tour?
Yeah, it's just a short tour. It's only 8 shows in England. We usually play America. We play, yeah, you know, bigger places. But it's nice to come to England and play for our fans here. We didn't want to attempt anything spectacular. Yeah. Just come and have a good time, you know.
Oh, well, yeah. So how long has it been since your last tour in England?
It's probably been like 10 or 12 years.
Oh, well, yeah.
I've done Rewind a couple of times. But that's not my band, that's me singing and playing backing band, you know, like a house band from Rewind. So this will be much better.
Have you done gigs in Wolverhampton before?
Not that I remember.
Oh, haven't you? how long has it been since like your last album?
Well, the album was put out last year, which was the Ascension album.
Yeah.
Which was basically done with the original band, although we didn't get together and make it.
Yeah.
We made it all in separate studios, and then an orchestra, you know, took the tracks and they added orchestral stuff to it, and it became like a walk back in time, you might say. Not really retro, because it's something we haven't done before.
Yeah.
So, but it's the songs are old songs revamped with an orchestra, and it worked out pretty good.
So, have you got a band supporting you tonight?
I do, but I'm not sure what they're called.
So you can't tell me what you're about.
They're called the Knights, apparently.
Oh, the Knights. So, what other venues and places are you playing in store?
We're playing in Dingwalls down in London.
Yeah.
I think it's 2 nights there.
Yeah.
We're playing the Cavern in Liverpool, which, you know, my guys coming, being an American band now, to them that's like spectacular. Because it's, you know, obviously where the Beatles played.
Yeah.
And we're going up to Glasgow. We're playing in Leeds and Bristol. I don't actually know the names of the places, because I don't even really look at the shows until like the day before we do them. We're here in England to do them, so, you know, it'll get done, put it that way.
do you recall where, like, in England, like your best crowd, or can you remember that?
Best crowd? Wow. I know early on we played, I think it was the Hammersmith Odeon or something like that, which was the first time in London we played to a really packed house.
Yeah.
And that was when we first got back off our first American tour. And, you know, we kind of left as nobodies and came back as, like, American stars, you know. So I think it was, like, a 3,000 size, and that was literally to come back to England and play a place like that sold out was a big shock to us, and it was great.
Oh.
It was kind of like, yes, we are we are good.
Yeah. So what are the atmosphere usually like?
We try and make it fun. You know, people come to see us to hear the hits.
Oh, yeah.
So once, you know, once you've got a crowd that's into you, I mean, they come to see you, so they wanna hear the hits and maybe a couple of songs that they like off albums and stuff like that. And the atmosphere, you know, it's always very friendly, very, I wouldn't say jolly, but, you know, people have a few beers and they get into it.
Oh, nice. So, can you tell me a bit about the new album?
The In Flight album is, the band itself, we didn't have that much to do with it.
Yeah.
It basically is extended and remixed orchestral stuff.
Is that the album called In Flight?
Yeah. And the tour is the In Flight tour.
Yeah.
Well, I think what happened was the tour was set up.
Yeah.
I called it the In Flight tour, and then the record company were already thinking of putting out some extended mixes and stuff, so they kind of rushed it to fit with the tour.
Mm.
And then because the tour was called In Flight, they said, well, let's call the album In Flight too. So I haven't heard it.
Oh, haven't you?
The new versions, no. But
do you know whether it's on like CD or vinyl or anything like that?
I like I said, I don't know that much about it. The record company asked me, was it okay to do it? And I said, sure, you know. I mean, any real collectors and all that, you know, they're like extended, they're like different. So I don't think it's like a major release, but it's going to be good for the, you know, our real fans.
Oh, so can we talk about the beginning, like how the band formed together and the music that inspired you to form the band?
You know, I'm basically from Liverpool. I mean, I wasn't born there, but been there since I was a little kid. Yeah. So I was in a band that got signed, and I was the bass player. And I didn't go along with the deal. Yeah. So I started my own band, which was called Level 7. And I had to drop that name because Level 42 came out.
Oh, yeah.
And so I changed it to A Flock of Seagulls because the Stranglers were my favorite band. Oh. And in the middle of one of their songs, he yells out A Flock of Seagulls. Mm. So went to see him live, and he pointed at me and said, A Flock of Seagulls. And I'm like, sign from God, you know?
Oh.
So yeah, we, you know, we got together. We, it was me, my brother on drums, and Frank on bass. And we tried probably 10 or 12 guitar players, and none of them kind of worked out. They were either playing blues, or they just weren't fitting in with what we were doing.
Wanted a new sound.
Yeah, so when Paul came along, and he was only, I think he was only like 17, he was basically listened to us, and he said, well, what do you want? So we told him, and he took that, and he expanded it into his own style. Oh. And it just fitted, you know. Once he was like, a lot of guitar players were very like set in their way of playing, and Paul wasn't. He was very open to suggestions and what he could do and couldn't do. And it was almost the last, you know, it was the last piece of the jigsaw. From the moment he joined, everything sounded exactly as we thought it should, you know.
Yeah.
We got a small deal with Bill Nelson's label, the Cocteau label, and we put out a couple of singles, and then from that we got a huge major deal. Even though the singles weren't hits, the company Jive Records that signed us, they liked where we were going, but new wave was not a thing then. It was just like, hang on, this band is doing something that we're not hearing big bands do. So they took a chance thinking that what we were doing may be the next thing. And luckily for us, it was.
So what was the music you was into at that time?
The music then was I into. There were bands like, you know, Ultravox, old Ultravox with John Fox and stuff like that. I was more into, like, I still liked the Beatles because the songwriting was great, the Rolling Stones. I still liked a lot of ethereal stuff, like some Pink Floyd stuff.
Oh, yeah.
I liked a little bit of punk, but, you know, punk was not where I wanted to be, put it that way. It was a great breakthrough, and it got rid of a lot of cobwebs and stuff in the music industry, but I think, you know, synths were inspiring me, and anything I heard with synths in it, I was like, how do they make that sound and all that. But we also, we liked rock and roll, not just to be synthy, like, say, Human League, but to have some power in there too. Because a lot of synth bands were very, you know, just little bippity-boppity sounds. We wanted to have rock band power, but with synthetic overtones. Mm. So, strangely enough, when we went to America for the first time to play, that's how they hooked to us, because all American bands are power rock. So they heard us and they were like, wow, they got power rock plus they're new and they're using synths and stuff. So that kind of proved to us that we'd moved in a new direction and we're doing the right thing.
So was it you that wrote all the lyrics and...
Yeah, I would say.
Yeah, and what was it you usually like to write about in music?
Flying saucers.
Yeah.
But I would say that, you know, what I would do is I'd come up with an idea for a song and a couple of lines of lyrics, and then I'd take it to rehearsal. And the band would just beat it up until it turned into a song, you know.
Oh.
So it's some of the songs were smaller pieces. Other songs like Wishing, Space Age, I did complete. You know, I finished them, but some other stuff like... Even, you know, Iran was a kind of, I would say, 50% me, 50% the band, you know.
Oh, nice. So, what was it like when, like, what was your first big hit?
Well, in America, it was, they had these huge dance charts in the colleges, and telecommunication was the biggest hit in the colleges. And, you know, once you have a big hit in the colleges, you kind of move up into commercial radio and stuff. So, although I Ran became the best-selling, other songs like Space Age and Wishing and It's Not Me Talking, they all got on commercial radio and touring, you know, we got us on big tours like the Synchronicity Tour with the Police. We toured with the Psychedelic Furs, with the Go-Go's. We played with Genesis, the Talking Heads. You know, it's kind of weird to go from, say, a club, a 1,000-size club up to 50, 60, 70,000-size football stadiums, basically, in a year. Most bands take 20 years to do it, you know.
So how did you feel when you... What was your feeling at that time playing?
Scary.
Was it?
Yeah,
was you really
scary
nervous?
Because, you know, you would go, oh, cool, we're playing a 3,000-size club in Philadelphia. Mm. And then 3 weeks later, you'd come back to Philadelphia and you're playing a 20,000-size, you know. And then 2 months after that, the Synchronicity Tour, 100,000 people there. Mm. So for us, it was all kind of like, wow, how high can this go? And, it you know, it's kind of like you look back at where you started in Liverpool in a little rehearsal room. Oh. And then you look out at an audience of 100,000 and you kind of get a shiver, you know, you're like, whoa, so, what if they don't like this, you know? But they're there to see you, so you know that they do like it.
What track was it that got you on Top of the Pops and that?
I think it was Wishing was the first one, I think. And that was our biggest hit in England.
Yeah.
I think Wishing, Transfer Affection, I don't really know because it wasn't really in England at that time, you know. Mm. I think we flew over to do Top of the Pops and then straight back to America, you know, where it was happening.
How many times did you end up on Top of the Pops?
I'm not sure, maybe three.
Yeah. What was he like being on that big British television like that?
Probably the most boring day of your life.
Was it because you... Was it miming back then, wasn't it?
I can't remember, but, you know, really you just sit around all day till they say, okay, go do a rehearsal, and then you go sit around again, and it's all timed down to the second because it's television. So you can't go anywhere. You just have to kind of sit there and keep out of the way, and then they go, okay, you guys get on, do your thing, and then get off, and thank you, good night. You know.
So was it all recorded live then?
I think it was live, but, of course, you know, we had other things to think of. It's kind of like... Let's get out of here by, you know, 6, 7 o'clock or whatever it was, and go to the hotel and go and do this, and tomorrow we're flying back to America, and all that kind of stuff, you know, rock and roll.
Oh, yeah, rock and roll. Do you ever look back on that stuff, like Top of the Pops, and do you ever look back and feel proud of your work? And
I don't ever think of it as being proud. I just think probably could do better.
Oh, really?
You know. I don't look at gold albums and things we've done and go, wow, that was great. Mm. I'm proud of my hairdo.
Oh, yeah.
Because there was nothing like it, and it's still talked about, so that's kind of...
Yeah, not everyone talks about the hairdo.
Yeah, but, you know, I don't...
Set up a fashion.
I don't look at songs and go, I'm proud of that. I kind of look at, say, Wishing and Space Age and go, however I got to that point writing them, I feel... Even those songs, I feel like I can do better than that. I can do better. So it's always your next song is your best song, and the one after that will be better, you know?
Need that ambition to get better and...
Yeah, and it's not ambition to be a bigger star. It's just ambition to within yourself, to do something, to reach out a little bit further, you know?
Did the band win many, like, Grammys or...?
We got a Grammy... And we got nominated for Grammys afterwards, but we only actually won one.
So in the future, have you got any future plans or future bigger tours or anything like that?
Well, this summer we're going out on the tour in America called the Lost 80s Tour, which is, I think it's 28 dates. And we're going to be out with Wang Chung and a few other bands. It's kind of like a, you know, it's a kind of a retro festival type thing. We did it last year and it was good fun. But, you know, we don't really plan that far ahead because there's no record companies these days. They just don't exist.
So I feel like these days, but it's, I think bands find it harder because you don't see many bands like bands with a different sound and that get signed on, really.
Yeah, it seems to me that if you haven't been with Disney or something like that, you're not going to get a deal, you know. It's
boys, rappers and that.
Yeah, you know, because they have their pathway to what they're doing.
Yeah.
But I think generally to be in a band these days is ridiculously tough. You have to do everything yourself.
Yeah.
And then at some point, if you're any good, a record company will go, oh, thank you, and take it off you and probably give you a crap deal.
Yeah.
You know, and then you might become a little bit bigger, but they make a bunch of money and then they just let you go. I don't think there's any like longevity or nurturing a band till they get really big, you know.
Yeah.
Like it used to be in the 60s, they, you know, they'd take a band on and the fifth album would be a big album. Now it's like if you're not a hit instantly, there's another band coming they'll take on. That's the way it seems anyway.
It's more singers, not really. You don't really see many bands these days, like on the charts.
No, it's all like you know, single people, isn't it? That are controlled by corporations.
Yeah, true. So, is there anything else you'd like to say in the podcast?
Come and see us live.
Yeah,
we have a lot of fun. It's we're on tour all the time. Look out for new stuff that's coming out. I'm just starting my second solo album. You know, we might do another Seagulls album, you never know.
That'd be brilliant, that one.
Keep your ears open, put it that way.
And before we finish, is there anything you'd like to say inspiring for the audience that'll be listening?
I would say if you're into music and a musician, don't do it to try and make it. Just do it because you enjoy it. And if you enjoy it, you'll get good at it and then you've got a chance. But, you know, don't get dispirited if it doesn't go your way. Just enjoy doing music.
Okay, thanks for talking to me. I really appreciate it. And cheers. Good luck with tonight and the tour.
Thanks a lot.
All right, cheers. Bye-bye.